Hello, today's video is Anatomy of Spinal Cord Part 3. Okay, in this video I'll be talking about different tracts, that is ascending and descending tracts, and related clinical aspects of these tracts. Now coming to the white matter area, as I told earlier, the white matter area has different group of nerve fibers. Okay, either some fibers are exiting out through the ventral root, and some fibers like afferent fibers are entering the spinal cord through the dorsal root. So when you see, when you concentrate on the white matter, these nerve fibers, they are sorted, okay, they form a groups having different function, okay. So these nerve fibers forming different groups are called as tracts. Tracts means a group of nerve fibers having specific function, okay. So when you see the white matter has different distribution of these tracts. So for the descriptive purpose, these tracts can be divided into ascending tracts. The ascending, that means from the peripheral area, they are ascending up to the higher center through the spinal cord, either to the cerebrum or to the brainstem or to the cerebellum. Okay, so these group of nerve fibers having specific functions which are ascending up to the higher center through the spinal cord are called as ascending tracts. And there are some group of nerve fibers also, they descend from the higher center to the periphery. So these are grouped under descending tracts. So for the descriptive purpose, the tracts are divided into ascending and descending tracts. So when you see here in this diagram, I have divided the spinal cord into two areas. The right area mainly I have drawn so that it will be clear. Okay, the right area mainly shows the descending tracts and the left area mainly shows the ascending tracts, so that I can clearly explain what are the ascending tracts and what are the descending tracts. Now, focusing on the right area, okay, so mainly here you see the descending tracts, okay, the tracts are distributed on both the sides. This is for the descriptive purpose, so in this diagram I have divided like this, okay. So these descending tracts, again they are subdivided into pyramidal tract and extra pyramidal tract. So what do you mean by pyramidal and extra pyramidal? Pyramidal tract are the one, okay, they are coming. The descending tracts mainly come from the cerebral cortex, the cerebral part of the cerebral cortex is a part of the cerebrum. So the fibers come and they pass through the spinal cord and then reach the effector organ, okay, to different muscles, okay. So the pyramidal tract are mainly concerned, the function of the pyramidal tract is they carry the information to the skeletal muscles, which helps in prime movement and skillful movements. For example, skillful movements are writing, okay, or playing musical instruments. All these are skillful movements, and also the prime movements of our body are mainly carried by the pyramidal tract. Okay, so the pyramidal tract mainly consists of two, okay, depending upon the regions where they are located. Lateral corticospinal tract, okay. Cortico means it is coming from the cerebral cortex and passing through the spinal cord. So that's why it is called as corticospinal tract. So most of the 80% of the fibers are located at the lateral area of the white matter. Okay, so as I told in my previous video, the white matter area has three, subdivided into three: posterior white column or funiculus, lateral white funiculus, and anterior white funiculus. So this corticospinal, the 80% of the fibers are situated here at the lateral white funiculus. So this is called as lateral corticospinal tract. And then some are present, about 10 to 20% are present here at the anterior white column. So these are called as anterior corticospinal tract. So these two corticospinal tract, lateral and anterior, okay, so the combined, they are called as pyramidal tract. Why it is called pyramidal? Because you will be learning about the brain stem. Okay, so in the medulla, there is an area called as pyramid. So these tracts, they cross over. okay, they cross to the opposite side and then come and relay in the spinal cord. They cross over at the level of this pyramid in the caudal medulla. Medulla oblongate as a part of the brainstem. Okay, so that's why these two tracts are combinedly called as pyramidal tract, which includes lateral and anterior corticospinal tract. So these are concerned with prime movement and skillful movements. Okay, fine skillful movements. Now coming to the extra pyramidal tract. Okay, so these, the tracts which come under extra pyramidal, they mainly maintain the muscle tone. Okay, they are also concerned with the movement. Okay, and they mainly maintain the muscle tone. Okay, so the extra pyramidal tract includes the rubrospinal, I am not named here, okay, rubrospinal tract, okay, then you have tectospinal, vestibulospinal, olivospinal, okay, so these all tracts have different functions, okay, and they are grouped under extra pyramidal tract, okay, so rubrospinal, tectospinal, vestibulospinal and olivospinal. So this is about the descending tract, which are descending from the higher center and passes through the spinal cord. Now coming here to the ascending tract, which are ascending up to the higher center through the spinal cord. So there are many tracts. So these ascending tracts are mainly afferent fibers. Descending are mainly efferent fibers. Okay. So the sensory fibers which enters through the posterior root after passing through the posterior ganglion, they have their cell bodies in the posterior ganglion or dorsal root ganglion. So after entering through the posterior root or the dorsal root, they are sorted and they are segregated into different tracts. Okay, so they are, so here at the posterior white column area, there are two funiculus, okay, or two tracts. These are combinedly called as posterior column or dorsal column because they are concerned at the posterior. They are situated at the posterior aspect. Okay, so they are called as posterior column or dorsal column. Okay, there are two fasciculus. Fasciculus is nothing but the other name for tract. Okay, so the medial one is called as fasciculus gracilis. Lateral one is called as, so I have differentiated by a black marker here. So medial one is called as fasciculus gracilis and lateral one is called as fasciculus cuneatus. So this tract is mainly concerned with sensations of proprioception, 2-point discrimination, vibration. Okay, so you know that the sensation which are carried by the sensory nerve fibers, so broadly they are classified into two, exteroceptive, because exteroceptive and interoceptive. Okay, so exteroceptive are the sensation which are carried from the external of the body, that means it, the sensation are carried from the sensory receptors present in the skin, superficial fascia and the mucous membrane, and those sensations which come under exteroceptive are pain, temperature, touch. Okay, touch, there is crude touch and fine touch, that is discriminative touch, 2-point discrimination, vibration. So these are all come under exteroceptive sensation, which have their sensory receptors in the skin, mucous membrane and superficial fascia. Okay, then interoceptive, okay, which are, they have the receptors deep to the body, that is within the body, either in the internal organs or in the viscera, okay, or in the deep group of muscles, okay, mainly in the muscles and the joints and tendons. So the sensation which come under these are proprioception. Okay, proprioception means sensation of movement of the muscle and the joints. Okay, so which will give the information about our position of our body and the posture. Okay, so these are the broad classification of sensation. So the posterior white, the posterior column or the dorsal column, which includes fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus, they are concerned with proprioception, okay, 2-point discrimination, where the person can discriminate that the two points are felt simultaneously. Okay, whether the distance is very minimal also, the person can differentiate that there is 2 points felt simultaneously. So that's called as 2-point discrimination. And also discriminative touch, where the person is aware that where exactly, at which part of the body that body has felt the touch, he can accurately localize. Okay, so this is called as fine touch or discriminative touch. Okay, and also proprioception, the joint movement, the muscle movement. Okay, so this is conscious proprioception. Again, proprioception has two types, conscious and unconscious. So the posterior column, which includes gracilis and cuneatus, they carry 2-point discrimination. I'll be writing here. So they carry 2-point discrimination. Discriminative touch or the fine touch, vibration sensation, and conscious proprioception, where we are aware, our conscious is aware of our movement. Okay, so these are carried by posterior column or the dorsal column. Okay, next you have, these are present here. Next you have two in this, which I marked here, which includes lateral and anterior spinothalamic tract. Okay, lateral, so this is lateral and this is anterior spinothalamic tract. These tracts have group of nerve fibers carrying the function, carrying the sensation of pain, temperature and crude touch. Okay, so lateral spinothalamic tract carries pain and temperature, anterior spinothalamic tract carries crude touch and pressure. Okay, so these are the two separate tracts. Okay, so lateral carries pain and temperature, anterior spinothalamic carries crude touch. Okay, it's different from fine touch. Okay, crude touch and pressure. Okay, so they are present here, lateral spinothalamic and anterior spinothalamic. The next other two ascending tracts are, here you can see, okay, I have written here, posterior and anterior spinocerebellar tract. Okay, posterior and anterior spinocerebellar, that means it travels from the spinal cord till the cerebellum. Okay, till the cerebellum. So these two tracts are concerned with unconscious proprioception. Okay, there is no necessary to think that our joint should be moved like this or muscle should be moved like this. Okay, so when you are walking, you no need to see your limb. Okay, so you can walk unconsciously, you can sit, if you are sitting in a position unconsciously. Okay, you no need to think that you have to position your body like this. Okay, so this is unconscious proprioception. Okay, so this is carried by spinocerebellar tract, which includes posterior and anterior. So these are about ascending tracts. Okay, ascending tracts, once again I'll tell you. Okay, the posterior column, okay, which includes gracilis and cuneatus, the medial fasciculus, gracilis mainly carries conscious proprioception, discrimination, native touch, 2-point discrimination and vibration from the lower aspect of the body. Okay, fasciculus gracilis from the lower aspect of the body and fasciculus cuneatus from the upper aspect of the body. So when you see in the different section, gracilis is present throughout the spinal cord segment. It is present, even starts from the sacral, then because it is ascending, right? So it starts from the sacral, you can see in the lumbar, thoracic and also in the cervical region, because it is carrying these sensation from the lower part of the body and it has to ascend to the higher center. The fasciculus cuneatus, which is carrying these sensation from the upper part of the body, so you won't see from the lower thoracic region, lumbar and sacral region. So cuneatus, fasciculus cuneatus is not seen at the lower thoracic, that is from T7 to T12 in the lumbar and sacral. Okay, cuneatus is present only at the upper thoracic and cervical region,
because upper part of the body. Okay, so that is the difference. So in combined, it is called as posterior or dorsal column. Okay, then you have lateral spinothalamic, anterior spinothalamic. Anterior spinothalamic carries crude touch and pressure. Lateral spinothalamic carries pain and temperature. Then you have posterior and anterior spinocerebellar tract, which carries unconscious proprioception from the muscle, joint, skin, superficial fascia. Okay, so this is about the ascending tracts. Now, in the ascending tracts, when you see, since it is passing through a long pathway, okay, so there are series of nerve fibers where the information, the sensory information, is carried by different neurons or series of nerve fibers. Okay, in common, there are mainly three order neurons. The three neurons carry the sensory information. Okay, so as you can see in this diagram, where the sensory, this is the sensory nerve receptor. Okay, there are different receptors in the skin, fascia, and in the muscle, and even in the joint. Okay, from there, this is the first order neuron, which is nothing but the peripheral process of the ganglion present in the dorsal root. Okay, I told earlier in the spinal nerve formation, there is a post, the dorsal root ganglion or spinal ganglion. There are a group of cell bodies which has peripheral process, which are traveling through, carrying the information from the sensory nerve receptors. Okay, then the central process entering the spinal cord. So this is the first order neuron. Okay, so after entering the spinal cord, this first order neuron synapses and passes the information to the second order neuron. Okay, second order neuron starts at the level of the spinal cord. Okay, most of the second order neuron, you will be learning different tracts. Okay, most of it, they cross over. Okay, can you see here? It crosses over to the opposite side and then ascends up through the brain stem. Okay, so this neuron is called as second order neuron and travels up to the thalamus. All the ascending tracts, they have to pass through the thalamus, then it enters the cerebral cortex. Okay, so except the spinocerebellar tract. Okay, they end at the level of cerebellum. So this is cerebellum. Okay, the first order neuron, after entering the spinal cord, they transfer the information to the second order neuron, which crosses over to the opposite side, then ascends till the thalamus. Then in the thalamus, the third order neuron starts. Again, there will be a synapse and the information is transferred into to the third order neuron, and the third order neuron reaches the cerebral cortex. So this is the common pathway followed by the ascending tracts, but it depends on different tracts. Some tracts can have only two, some have more than three. Okay, but commonly most of the tracts have three order neurons, first, second, and the third order neurons. Now let us know about each tract, their pathway in detail. First is the spinothalamic tract, which includes lateral and anterior spinothalamic. Okay, lateral carries pain and temperature, anterior carries crude touch and pressure. So how is the pathway? As I told, the sensory receptors are present. Okay, the peripheral process of the ganglion present in the dorsal root, they enter. So this is the dorsal root. Okay, and the central process, it enters the tip of the posterior gray column, where the substantia gelatinosa are present. Then they synapse. The first order ends here. Okay, then the information is transferred into the second order neuron. Before ascending up, this second order neuron, both lateral and anterior spinothalamic, they cross over to the opposite side. Okay, they cross over to the opposite side and then they ascend up, enters the brainstem. Okay, then
enters the spine, the thalamus. Okay, so this ends the second order neuron. Okay, then from the thalamus, the third order neuron arises, and then it enters the posterior central gyrus of the cerebral cortex. So the crossing over is at the level of the spinal cord, both lateral and anterior spinothalamic. Okay, after the medulla, the anterior and lateral spinothalamic, they join together, they combine together to form a lemniscus called as spinal lemniscus. Lemniscus is not nothing but again group of nerve fibers having a specific function. Okay, the same function. Okay, so in the spinal cord level, they are separate due to the location. Okay, lateral spinothalamic, anterior spinothalamic. Okay, after they ascend through the brainstem, at the section of the brainstem, both will get combined to form the spinal lemniscus, enters the thalamus. Okay, from there to the cerebral cortex. So this is the spinothalamic tract. Next, coming to the posterior column, so which includes fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus. So the function, once again I would like to tell, so it carries conscious proprioception, discriminative touch, two-point discrimination, and vibration. So all these sensations are carried by the posterior column. So this posterior column again enters through the dorsal root. The sensory receptors from here in the ganglion, the peripheral process enters, the central process enters the spinal cord. Okay, and after entering the spinal cord, it enters here. After entering the spinal cord, they ascend ipsilaterally. They don't cross over. Please note here. Okay, they don't cross over. Ipsilaterally they ascend. Okay, at the level of medulla, they synapse. So here they are not synapsing. This is complete first order neuron. Okay, they come to the posterior white column. Okay, then they ascend at the spine, the medullary region. This is medulla. Okay, at the medullary region there are two nuclei. Again, it is named the same, nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus, which are present at the medulla. There they synapse and the second order neuron arises. Okay, so this is the second order neuron of the posterior column. So second order neuron of the posterior column is present at the level of medulla. So the decussation means the crossing over occurs at the level of medulla. So since it is a decussation of the sensation, so it's also called a sensory decussation. And the fibers which are decussating, that is crossing, are called as internal arcuate fibers. They have given the special name. Okay, so the fibers of the posterior column which are crossing over at the level of medulla, okay, the second order neuron. So those second order neuron of the posterior column decussating at the level of medulla are called as internal arcuate fibers. Then they ascend contralaterally, the second order neuron. So they all group together, they are called as medial lemniscus. Once again, this is the first order neuron entering the posterior white column, ascend ipsilaterally, come to the medulla, and they synapse. The second order neuron arises. Okay, then the second order neuron crosses over, and the second order neuron are called as internal arcuate fibers. After crossing over, the group of fibers ascending up till the thalamus will be called as medial lemniscus. Okay, then enters the thalamus. Then the third order neuron arises from the thalamus, enters the cerebral cortex. So this is the pathway of posterior column, or having fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus. So please note the difference. Spinothalamic have their nucleus and they cross over. Okay, the second order neuron and the crossing over is at the same spinal cord level. But posterior column, the second order neuron, the nucleus are present. The nuclei are present at the level of medulla, which are called as nucleus gracilis and cuneatus. And crossing over occurs at the medullary region. Okay, after crossing over, they are called as medial lemniscus, and then they enter the cerebral cortex. The next tract, the next ascending tract, which carries the unconscious proprioception. So those tracts doesn't enter the cerebral cortex. They enter the cerebellum. So they are called as spinocerebellar tract. So which includes posterior and anterior spinocerebellar. Okay. So these the posterior spinocerebellar and anterior spinocerebellar. Again, the first order neuron enters the spinal cord. They enter the spinal cord, the posterior. Now I am talking about the posterior spinocerebella. Enter the spinal cord, then ascend ipsilaterally, okay, passing through the medulla, pons, okay, then enters the cerebellum, okay. So they are not crossing over, okay, they are ascending ipsilaterally and then enter the cerebellum. But anterior spinocerebellar, you see, they cross over twice. So they enter the spinal cord, okay, they cross over, then they ascend up, okay, again they cross over, again they cross over and come. So if you divide this into two, so they cross over at the level of spinal cord. This is the first crossover. Okay, after passing through the brainstem, when it comes to the cerebellum, again they cross over and come to the cerebellum. So anterior spinocerebella crosses twice, but posterior spinocerebella doesn't cross. So the spinocerebella, where the information reaches to the cerebellum, controls the same side, ipsilateral side of the body. So this you have to remember. Okay, so this is about the three tracts: spinothalamic, posterior column, and spinocerebellar, which is the most important. Now coming to the descending tracts. So as I told earlier, the descending tracts are divided into two: pyramidal tract, which includes lateral corticospinal, okay, and anterior corticospinal. And then the other group is the extra pyramidal tract, which includes rubrospinal, tectospinal, vestibulospinal, and oligospinal. So both are concerned with the movement, the voluntary movements of our body. The prime voluntary movements and the skillful movements are controlled by the pyramidal tract. Okay, so other minor movements and also maintaining our posture, the muscle tone. Okay, what do you mean by muscle tone? It is the muscle tone is the partial contraction state of our body. Okay, so whenever you are doing any movement, okay, there will be partial resistance. So that is called as the partial contraction, contracted state of the body is called the muscle tone. So it is, again, it is controlled by the extra pyramidal tract. Okay, so when you see the extra pyramidal tract, the pathway, so it is descending tract. So they descend from higher to lower. Okay, from the cerebral cortex, they come from the different areas of the cerebral cortex. Okay, then they form an internal capsule. They enter the internal capsule. They join to form corona radiata. Then they enter the internal capsule, descend downwards, and at the level of caudal medulla, they cross over. Okay, so this is called as pyramidal dissociation. Okay, so there is an area called as pyramid in the medulla. So at that area, okay, 80% to 90% of the fibers cross over at the caudal medullary region. Okay, and then they come to the spinal cord level, and occupy the lateral aspect of the white matter, and this is called as the 80% to 90% which cross over at the level of medulla. So they are called as lateral corticospinal tract. The remaining 10% to 20% of the fibers which doesn't cross over, okay, they come to the spinal cord level, and then again they cross over, and then they come. So they cross over at the level of spinal cord. Okay, so it's about very minimal number of fibers, that is 10% to 20%. Most of the fibers, they cross over at the medullary region. Okay, and they occupy the anterior white column, and they are called as anterior corticospinal tract. So this is about the descending tract. So from the cerebral cortex, they form corona radiata, enter the internal capsule, come to the midbrain, okay, then to the pons, then at the caudal end of the medulla, most of the fibers, 80% to 90% of the fibers, cross over, come to the opposite side of the lateral white column to form lateral corticospinal tract, and anterior corticospinal, they won't cross over, that is about 10% to 20%, they won't cross over at the medullary region, but they cross over at the level of spinal cord, and then occupy the anterior white column, and they are called as anterior corticospinal tract. Okay, now you have learnt about each tracts, their pathway, the ascending and the descending. One more thing I wanted to specify in the descending tract is about the upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron. Okay, so lower motor neurons are those neurons which are present at the anterior gray column. Okay, and the neurons which form the anterior root. Okay, so at that level, if you see the neurons which are present at the anterior gray column, sending the fibers to form the anterior root of the ventral root, so they form the lower motor neuron, and the neuron, the nerve fibers at the supraspinal of that segment, okay, above that segment, spinal segment, those are called as upper motor neurons. So these two you have to remember, the upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron. So lower motor neuron are mainly present in the anterior gray column, and which forms the ventral root, and the neurons which are present above that segment level are called as upper motor neuron. Now coming to the different lesions, okay, the upper motor neuron lesion and the lower motor neuron lesion, there are differences between these two, upper motor UML and LML. Okay, so how to identify if the patient comes with different signs and symptoms, how to diagnose whether it is lower motor or upper motor neuron lesion. Okay, so in the lower motor, as I told, they have the group of cell bodies present in the gray column. Okay, and also they have cell bodies which forms the reflex arc. Okay, so what do you mean by reflex? Reflex is an involuntary movement in response to the stimulus. Okay, so this reflexes, you have different reflexes, superficial abdominal reflex, then you have deep tendon reflexes. Okay, the reflexes are different types which are mainly controlled at that spinal cord level, and also in turn they are controlled by the pyramidal tract, mainly the extra pyramidal tract. Okay, so at each level of the spinal cord, there are reflex arcs which are formed by some of the anatomical structures, which includes the receptor organ, okay, then the afferent neuron, then it enters the efferent neuron, then it's the effector organ. So these are the parts or the structures which forms the reflex arc at each level of the spinal cord. Okay, so this is at the lower motor neuron level. Okay, so this controls some of the reflexes and some of the movements of the body, the involuntary movements of the joints in response to the stimulus. So whenever there is damage to any parts of this reflex arc, there will be the abolition, okay, there will be no function of this reflex arc and there will be absence of the reflexes. Also, this reflex arc maintains the muscle tone, which is in relation to our body posture. As I told, the extrapyramidal tract also have a control on the muscle tone, okay, and our muscle tone is also maintained by the these reflex arc. The muscle tone is nothing but continuous partial contraction of the muscle to maintain the body posture. Okay, so whenever there is any damage to any parts of this reflex arc, there will be complete absence of the reflexes and there will be hypotonia. The tone of the muscle decreases, okay, and the movement will be flaccid. Okay, when you feel the muscle, there won't be any partial contraction, continuous partial contraction, and when you feel the muscle, it will be soft and flabby, okay, and the movement will be very flaccid in nature and there will be absence of complete reflexes. So this is one of the signs of lower motor neuron lesion. So what happens? There will be muscle atrophy, okay, then there will be hypotonia, because in the lower motor, because the neurons which are present at the lower motor area are concerned with the reflex arc, okay, and also they maintain the muscle tone. Since the arc is damaged, there will be the muscle tone will be decreased, there will be absence of all the reflexes, absence of all reflexes, okay, that is superficial and deep, both are absent. Okay, then there will be muscle atrophy, hypotonia, absence of all reflexes, and there will be flaccid paralysis. So if you see the paralysis, it can be ipsilateral or contralateral depending upon where the lesion is. Okay, so there will be flaccid paralysis where the movement will be very flaccid, okay, and when you feel the muscle, it will be soft, though in feeling, okay, and it will be flabby. The upper motor, okay, which is above this level, if you see, the reflex arc is not affected. It is above that level, okay, the supraspinal level. So the neurons which are present in the cerebral cortex and in the brainstem, okay, so those are the neurons which are damaged. So what happens? The reflex is not affected, okay. So what happens that time? And the tone will be present, it will be hypertonia, because so this reflex arc, though it has a function of maintaining the muscle tone, there won't be any control from the higher center, okay. So in a group of class, okay, for example, there should be a control from a teacher, okay. If there is no control from a teacher, the class students will be hyperactive, right. So the tone, though it is maintained by the reflex arc, okay, the inhibition and excitation is mainly controlled from the higher centers. Since higher centers are nothing but the neurons which are present in the cerebral cortex and the brainstem. So if there is no function from this corticospinal and extrapyramidal tract, so what happens? The tone, the reflexes will be hyperactive. So what happens? There will be hypertonia. There will be hypertonia. The tone of the muscle increases. Okay, then there will be increase in the deep tendon reflexes. Okay, deep tendon reflexes are exaggerated. Okay, but superficial reflexes will be absent. that is superficial abdominal reflexes will be absent, but deep tendon reflexes will be exaggerated. For example, knee jerk, bicep jerk, okay, those reflexes will be exaggerated, but superficial abdominal reflex, crimastric reflex will be absent. Okay, then since the tonus increased, the contraction will be more. So when you ask the patient to do the passive movement, there will be rigidity. Okay, this is called as clasp knife rigidity. Okay, so the patient will have spastic paralysis. Okay, the movements will be very rigid and spastic in nature. Okay, and the very important sign which you have to know is the Babinski sign. Okay, Babinski sign will be present, will be positive. What do you mean by Babinski sign? Okay, Babinski sign, the normal response. Okay, so imagine this is the sole. I will show my hand. Imagine this is the foot. Okay, this is the plantar aspect, the dorsum of the foot. This is the sole of the foot. Okay, how this reflex is elicited? So if you take a scratch the lateral aspect of the sole of the foot and come towards the great toe. Okay, when you scratch, normally what happens due to the effect from the corticospinal tract, so there will be plantar flexion of all the toes. Okay, there will be plantar flexion of all the toes, which is abnormal. That means Babinski sign is negative. So in upper motor, if there is damage to the corticospinal tract, if the corticospinal tract is non-functional, so what happens when you scratch the lateral aspect of the sole of the foot? So there will be withdrawal reflex due to the action of extrapyramidal other tract, other descending tracts, if they are active. Okay, and the corticospinal will be non-functional, but due to the effect of other tracts, there will be withdrawal reflex where there will be dorsiflexion of the great toe and fanning out of the other toes. So this is called as Babinski sign positive, which is a withdrawal reflex, which gives a sign that the patient is having upper motor neuron lesion. Mainly, there is a damage to corticospinal tract. One more thing you have to remember, Babinski sign is positive up to first year of life. It is normally present till the baby attains 1 year, because corticospinal tract until 1 year, they won't be myelinated. After 1 year, they get myelinated, and Babinski sign will be negative after 1 year of age. So up to 1 year of age, the Babinski sign will be present normally. Okay, after that it will be negative, that will be normal, there will be plantar flexion due to the action of corticospinal. So in what happens in upper motor, due to non-function of the pyramidal tract, so Babinski sign will be positive. They'll have withdrawal reflex, fanning out of the toes, and dorsiflexion of the great toe. So these are the signs and symptoms which you have to remember, and this will help you to diagnose whether the patient having these signs, whether they are having upper motor neuron lesion or lower motor neuron lesion. Next, coming to the clinical syndromes, okay, which are associated with spinal cord injuries, which you have to know. It's very important syndromes which are associated with the spinal cord injuries. Before I start that, you have to know one. You have to keep in mind how to know whether which level of the spinal cord is affected. Okay, this depends upon where is the sign and symptoms, whether it is ipsilateral side or contralateral side. Okay, so this helps you to diagnose. Okay, so you have to remember when I told about the ascending and the descending tracts, the tracts cross over a different level. Okay, let wherever the tract cross over, let it decussate wherever. Okay, now this is the right side, this is left side. There are some tracts here, there are some tracts here. Okay, imagine they are crossing over here. Okay, and this is supplying. So these group of nerve fibers are supplying the right side of the body, and this is supplying left side of the body. Okay. So if the lesion is below the decussation, okay, sorry, above the decussation, imagine if there is damage here on the right fibers, okay, above the crossing over, above the decussation. So what happens? So the nerve fibers are controlling which side, left side of the body. So the whatever the function might be, there will be signs and symptoms affecting the left side of the body, because this is above the crossing over, above the decussation. So the signs and symptoms are seen on the contralateral side. If the lesion is below the decussation, okay, the crossing over has already has happened, okay. If the damage is below the decussation, so what happens? The fibers have crossed over, then the damage has happened. So the signs and symptoms will be seen on the ipsilateral side, okay. So if you see, if the lesion is here, so the crossing over has already happened, okay, then the damage has occurred. So the signs and symptoms will be seen on the ipsilateral side. So this you have to remember. So one good example I want to give is the posterior gray column, sorry, the posterior column, which carries conscious proprioception, fine touch, vibration, 2-point discrimination. So remember where it crosses over. It doesn't cross over at the spinal cord level. It crosses over at the medullary region. So if the lesion is at the spinal cord level, okay, it is below the crossing over, because the crossing over is occurring at the higher level, at the medullary region, in the brainstem, okay. But the lesion is below the crossing over. So whenever there is any damage to the spinal cord of that level, so you will see signs and symptoms at the ipsilateral side. But if it is above the crossing over, imagine the damage is at the pons level, okay. So what happens? The fibers are crossing over where? They cross over at the medullary region, but the damage is above, at the pons level, okay. So you will see the signs and symptoms on the contralateral side. So this you have to remember before I talk about different syndromes. So there are the syndromes, the name has been given according to the location where the injury occurred. Okay, so there can be complete spinal cord injury. Okay, there can be complete spinal cord syndrome where the whole spinal cord can be affected. Okay, so what happens at different cord segment? Okay, so what happens? There will be complete loss of both voluntary paralysis. There will be paralysis. Okay, there will be loss of all sensation. Okay, so what happens? If it is at the level of cervical region, so what happens at that level where the damage has occurred? Okay, so there will be lower motor neuron lesion. Okay, so here the lower motor reflex arc is formed. Okay, so what happens? There will be flaccid paralysis at the level of the lesion, but below the level of the lesion, there will be spastic paralysis. So this you should remember. Imagine this is at the C6 level. Okay, so there is damage at the C6 level. So what do you see? The spinal nerves which are arising from the C6 spinal cord segment, the area which is supplied from that spinal cord segment, they'll have flaccid paralysis because it is lower motor neuron lesion. The reflex arc is affected at that level. But below C6, whatever the fibers which are descending from that level, okay, so for them it is upper motor, so they'll have upper motor neuron lesion. Okay, so there will be lower motor neuron lesion at the level of the damage, and upper motor neuron lesion below the level of the damage. Okay, that is flaccid paralysis at the level of the lesion and spastic paralysis below the level of the lesion. Even the sensation differs, okay, whether it is ipsilateral or contralateral. Very good example I give is about the Brown-Sequard syndrome. This is also called as hemisection of spinal cord, where half of the spinal cord is affected. okay, half of the spinal cord is affected. The reason can be anything. It can be vascular trauma or infection due to poliomyelitis or due to neoplasm. Okay, so the half part of the spinal cord is affected. So what happens? Again, at that level, there will be lower motor neuron lesion. Okay, there will be spastic or upper motor neuron lesion. Okay, below that spinal cord level. Okay, below the damage. That's about the descending tract. What about the ascending tract? So what are the ascending tracts you see here? Okay, imagine the tracts here. So you have lateral spinothalamic, anterior spinothalamic. Lateral and anterior spinothalamic, they carry pain, temperature, crude touch and pressure from opposite side. Please remember, lateral and anterior spinothalamic, they cross over at the spinal cord level. So if there is a damage here, okay, so they are having the tract which have already crossed over. So you will have loss of pain, temperature, then touch and pressure, crude touch and pressure on the contralateral side below that level of the lesion. Okay, below that level of the lesion, the contralateral side, there will be loss of pain, touch, temperature, that is crude touch and pressure. Okay, this is about lateral spinothalamic. Okay, what about the posterior column? So you know that posterior column crossover where? At the level of medulla. Okay, so here it is below the crossing. Okay, so where do you see loss of the 2-point discrimination, conscious proprioception, then discriminative touch, that is fine touch, is lost on the ipsilateral side. Okay, so this is the difference you have to know. Okay, loss of pain, temperature, pressure, crude touch on the contralateral side below the lesion. Okay, and loss of conscious proprioception. Okay, 2-point discrimination, discriminative touch, vibration on the ipsilateral side is lost in the Brown-Sequard syndrome. Okay, along with that, descending tracts are affected. There will be flaccid or lower motor neuron damage at the level of the lesion and spastic paralysis below the level of the lesion. Okay, so this you have to remember in the Brown-Sequard syndrome. Okay, just proprioception, then discriminative touch, that is fine touch, is lost on the ipsilateral side. Okay, so this is the difference you have to know. Okay, loss of pain, temperature, pressure, crude touch on the contralateral side below the lesion. Okay, and loss of conscious proprioception. Okay, 2-point discrimination, discriminative touch, vibration on the ipsilateral side is lost in the Brown-Sequard syndrome. Okay, along with that, descending tracts are affected. There will be flaccid or lower motor neuron damage at the level of the lesion and spastic paralysis below the level of the lesion. Okay, so this you have to remember in the Brown-Sequard syndrome. Okay, so with this clinical signs and symptoms, you can diagnose what the patient is suffering from, which syndrome, which spinal level is affected. Okay, or syndrome like anterior cord syndrome, only the anterior part of the spinal cord is affected. So again, here what happens, there will be bilateral, because both the sides. So bilateral loss of, there will be lower motor neuron lesion at the level of the damage. Okay, bilateral spastic paralysis below the level of the damage. Okay, then loss of pain, touch, temperature on both the sides, because it is both. Okay, but conscious proprioception, discriminative touch, 2-point discrimination will be spared, will be present, because it is at the posterior aspect, not in the anterior aspect. In anterior cord syndrome, only the anterior part of the spinal cord is affected. Okay, so this you have to remember in different syndrome. Okay, and you have to correlate with the different tracts, their function, where, at which level they cross over. Okay, which will help you to diagnose different syndromes. So that completes anatomy of spinal cord. Thank you very much.